Hey guys, thank you for joining me again on this quick DIY. Today we're working on a 1987 BMW 325 IS. We're gonna go over the how-to as far as a rear brake job is considered. The same setup's gonna be applicable to your E36 and E46 platforms for the most part. Part numbers are gonna change a little bit and sizes of things are gonna change a little bit, but the idea remains the same. We have the piston compressor. We have your 5 and 7 millimeter hex, followed by your 17 millimeter socket, 17 millimeter deep socket for the wheel lug bolts, 3/8 ratchet, 1 flathead, 1 hammer, and 1 breaker bar to remove the wheels. In addition, we're gonna do a little unboxing for you guys, just so you can see what to expect if you order this same brake set. All these parts you can find in our link below in the description box. So, as I was saying before, you're gonna get 2 rotors in this box. Again, I went with the solid face. You can get the drilled ones, they look awesome, but for me, just not something I need. The front ones are also blank solid faces, so I'd like them to match. These are zinc coated, just like every Zimmerman rotor is, so all this isn't gonna rust in comparison to the ones that we're about to take off, which you guys will see in a minute. They are all crusty looking, they look terrible. Then from there, we are gonna go ahead and get some ATEs on there. These are actually OE for the E30. They're exactly what these cars left with from the factory. This one probably back in 87. And same thing, you're gonna get your 2 pads, semi-metallic compound, pretty straightforward. And then this stuff is what we're gonna use to apply like on the backing plate here and a little bit on these ends where they make contact with the caliper, just so they don't seize up so they can move around freely when need to, but also do their job when you're going to stop. And last but not least, we already saw these before, but the 2 rotor set screws, I'll show you guys where these go, how to take them off, and a couple tricks in case they're stuck on your car from rust or age, whatever the case may be. All right, let's get set up and I'll show you guys what to do. So on this car, I have regular lug bolts. I don't have studs or anything aftermarket, so it's going to require a 17 millimeter socket to get those off. I always like to break these free just a little bit before I get the car up in the air, since I don't have an impact gun to zap them off with. So I'll go ahead and break them free. Then I'm going to bring over my floor jack and I'll get the car raised up and I'll show you guys a little bit of a better close up on where to put your floor jack. Go from there. Just to show you quickly, on the E30s, you're gonna have a jacking point in the back here. See where those 2 hex nuts are? So that's gonna be a piece of reinforced metal on the pinch weld, if you will, that you can use to jack up your E30 safely. A lot of these cars, as they age, sometimes those parts rot out. You're gonna have to go in from underneath and jack off the subframe. In this case, this is a Cali car. It's pretty clean, little to no rust on it. So these guys are still intact. They're still structural. So we're gonna go ahead and jack up the E30 from there. Always keep in mind, if you have a driveway that has an incline or your car's on a hill, you wanna make sure to chalk your wheels. In this case, we have a chalk on the front 2 wheels, even though the car is on completely level ground. You can never be too safe. All right, guys, now that we've gotten the car up to a suitable height, as always, you want to be safe. We're going to go ahead and get our jack stand situated. Again, even though we're not going to be under the car too much, it's always good to be safe and be protected. And also, you don't want the car to drop down if you don't have to, if you can avoid it. Now that that's good to go, we're gonna go ahead and fully take off the 4 lug bolts and remove the wheel. And then we can show you what to look for as far as the signs that you're gonna need new brakes or how they look when you need new brakes. And or in this case, it's gonna be a combination of deterioration as well as bad lips on the rotors. And just like that, those are free and the wheel comes off. Now, on this car, I'm running a small spacer. If you have a spacer too or not, just make sure it comes off. In this case, this one stuck to the old rotor. I'm gonna grab myself a little pry tool, get that guy off, and then we can proceed from there. All right, baby, got the good old hammer. This is, again, probably overkill, but I might be wrong, boys. Due to age and Mother Nature, it's frozen itself onto the old rotor. I'm gonna take a rubber mallet to try to course it off. I don't really want to hit it with a regular hammer. This is soft, it'll get marred. So we'll try to hit it off a little bit. Either way, it'll come off. Well, what do you know? It ain't coming off.
1 hour later.
There we go, baby. Come on, babe. All right, yeah. Well, you can see all the rust that has formed here over the years. Getting this bad boy stuck on there. Not to worry, we're gonna go ahead and take a wire wheel. We'll get all the rust off of here. The hub will be nice and clean before we put the new stuff on. Now that we have everything off, we can take a better look at the brakes here. What we're looking for on this rotor is the face, the condition of the face that we can see. So right there, my finger gets stuck. And same thing down here. You can feel that lip. Looking at the pads themselves, they have a lot of meat left to them still, but they are super old. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is get the wire wheel out. Again, this is simply just for me, because I'm gonna paint these off camera. I'm gonna get the wire wheel out. I'm gonna go ahead and hit all the surface that I can here just to clean them up a little bit. And then we'll go ahead and we'll get the right hex socket to get these guide pins out and get the caliper off. If you're gonna wire wheel your calipers, just be mindful in here you have part of your dust seal for the piston. Be careful not to hit it. Especially if it's not in bad shape, you won't have to replace it. If you rip it, then that's gonna cause you problems. So just be mindful that that's in here. Same thing if you guys are just painting your calipers while it's on the car. While it's easy to do, there's a lot of things to consider. You don't wanna get paint on the pads. You don't wanna get paint on the rotors in these areas that you can't really cover up. In addition to that, you have that dust seal here. If you get paint on that, you're gonna shorten the integrity and the life of that seal. We're gonna go ahead and hit everything with a little bit of brake cleaner. This is just my personal preference. You don't have to, but I like to kind of clean everything up as I go, just to A, not get so dirty, and B, be able to really inspect everything as I'm taking it apart. That's all you need for now, nothing crazy. All right, let's get this caliper off. Before you go ahead and get off your guide pins out, you're gonna wanna go ahead and remove this anti-rattle clip. I use a little flathead, just pry them out of their home. And just like that, this guy comes off. Put this to the side, you're gonna need it again. All right, guys, thank you for joining me underneath the car here. A little bit less lighting, but hopefully you can see what we have going on here. Normally you're gonna have two little dust caps, top and bottom here, that you're gonna pop off. From there, you're gonna take your 7mm hex, make sure your ratchet's on the off position, and go ahead and get these off. I like to break them free before I go ahead and do both fully. And from there, I'll remove the top one and then work on the bottom one. Sometimes you can use the socket here to get the guide pin out by cocking it at an angle and pulling back with it, and it should come right out. And bam. All right, guys, now that we got the caliper guide pins out, we have our anti-rattle clip. On this car, the brake sensors have long time stopped working. To be quite honest, I'm not even sure if they're equipped to the car anymore, other than being in place. But This is the part where you'd want to go ahead and pull out your brake sensor from the brake pad. Leave that to the side for now. From there, you're going to go ahead and remove the caliper. Might fight you a little bit off the car. So be mindful, this front brake pad usually falls out of place. Now, in this car, for me, it's a little bit different. I have a stainless steel brake line, or brake hose, if you will, so it's going to fight me a little bit. But what you want to do is get your, keep your old pad, if you're using a tool like this, on the caliper, and that way this gnarly tip doesn't mar, for example, your new pad or the piston. So you're going to want to go ahead and put this in place like so. This backing plate mimics the front pad, if you will, and just sits nicely into place like so. Go ahead and thread this guy in. Now that it's got some pressure on it, you can see how it sits in here. And now you just want to go ahead and twist it until it pushes and compresses the piston all the way back into the caliper housing. Keep an eye on it. Make sure your dust seal isn't binding up anywhere funny. Make sure, you know, it's not fighting you or going in cocked. This one went in super easy. That's about as far as it goes. Again, these pads were not terrible. The rotors are pretty crusty, but they were very old. But you can see they still have a ton of meat left on them, but we're going to go ahead and freshen them up while we're, because we can. Now that that's out, go ahead and pop your old brake pad off. Look at all that old crust on there. That's pretty gross. Before we install our new pads on here, we will be cleaning off these surfaces and getting them ready for the new pads. I'm gonna get myself a zip tie ready, and I'm gonna use this hook right here just to hook the caliper by there. So it's off to the side and out of the way while we work on getting the rotor off. So zip tie action through there. One through there. And that's it. Your caliper's off to the side. It's not dangling on the brake hose, and you are good to go. Next, we're gonna work on getting this set screw off of the hub so that this whole rotor can break loose. Now, I like doing this before I take the caliper bracket off in case that this is seized on here and you need to hammer it off a little bit. When it breaks free with the hammer, it's not gonna shoot off and hit you. It's gonna be held in place still by this bracket. You can choose whichever order you wanna do this. If you're just doing your pads, skip this step. Simply reverse the removal of the pad removal and start putting them back together. To get the set screw off, you're gonna wanna use a 5mm hex socket. Just like that. Hell yeah, baby. For me, just a little love tap from the hammer before you go ahead and take it off to break off any rust. And just like that, we get this bad boy off. That was a 5mm hex to get that set screw off. This guy's stuck on there. I'm gonna go ahead and hit it a couple times with the hammer, free it loose. And just like that, she's good to come off. We'll let it sit there for now. And now we're gonna go ahead and work on getting these caliper brackets off. I'll take you behind the scenes with me and show you how those comes off. Hell yeah, baby. All right, now that we are underneath the car once more, we are gonna go ahead and remove the caliper bracket. For that, you're gonna have two 17mm bolts that hold it into place. So these are typically a little bit tighter on there than your guide pins. They might fight you a little bit. You might need a breaker bar. I'm gonna go at it with the ratchet and see how far we get. And if it's too stubborn, I'll come back with a breaker bar and we'll get them off like that. Same thing, make sure your ratchet's in the off or remove position. I have a habit of tightening stuff before I loosen it. All right, that's one. And that's two. And like always for me, I like to do the top one before I remove the bottom one. Just a little bit easier to get to and a little bit easier to control it when it falls off. All right, we're gonna go ahead and, now that we got that one finger loose, we'll go ahead and take it off by hand. Again, there's a second one that is off. This comes off and put it to the side. Keep in mind, if you took that set screw off beforehand like I do, and this is loose, just keep in mind that it can fall off, so keep it pushed back against the hub until you're ready to remove it. Now that we have the caliper bracket removed, it's gonna look like this. Yours might be a little bit more crusty, a little less crusty. We'll clean it up before it goes on. Again, this is all gonna get painted off camera, but for sake of the DIY, we're still gonna clean it. We got our rotor off. You can see the inside marks where those parking brake shoes make contact. But otherwise, everything looks pretty decent other than the lip on them. Again, these are very old. I don't know how long they've been on the car, but we're gonna go ahead and remove them. This is something you're gonna wanna clean up before you put your new rotor on. I'm gonna take the wire wheel to mine and just clean this whole surface up so I know I have a good mating surface for the new rotor. This parking brake assembly, or parking brake shoe assembly, if you will, might need to be adjusted before the new rotors can fit on. These have plenty of shoe left on them, plenty of bite, plenty of material, so I'm not gonna worry about replacing them. They've always worked well. But I'm gonna go ahead and brake clean everything as I have it apart. So, first little wire wheel action. I'm gonna brake clean everything. And then before the new rotor goes on, we're gonna put a little bit of good stuff on here. In this case, I'm gonna use the Lick-A-Molly ceramic paste just to keep the new rotor from seizing on. Not that we're gonna be doing brakes anytime soon again, but you never know. A little bit of brake clean action. All right, guys, from there, our surface is ready. I'm gonna go ahead and get my Lick-A-Molly ceramic paste. I'm gonna go ahead and apply a little bit here. I'm gonna apply a little bit to the face here, and I'm gonna get our new rotor ready to be put on. So we got our Lick-A-Molly anti-squeal paste. So you wanna remove the cap. It's gonna have a threaded top on there. This is gonna go on like so, and it's just gonna thread into place. Once it's on like that, this is going to act as your trigger to actuate it, and you'll see it come out from here. And here she goes. You can see the blue paste right there. Don't be shy with it. It's not going to hurt anything. Another thing to keep in mind, guys, your gloves while you're working on something like this. The new rotors come zinc coated, but you cannot brake clean them or you will deteriorate the coating on them. So if you care about keeping them spot free, just try to keep your mitts clean as you're grabbing them. I went ahead and degreased my gloves off of camera. And there we have it. Gonna go ahead and line up your holes, line up your set screw hole, and go ahead and get that guy into place. Again, it's a 5mm hex to get this little guy back into its home. All right, guys, now that you've threaded in your rotor set screw, it doesn't really take a lot of torque to get them in there. If you wanna torque them down anywhere between 8 and 10 foot-pounds at most is going to be all you need, or 12 newton meters if you will. That's it. Never hurts to put a little bit of anti-seize on there. In this case, I got a little bit of that paste on there just so that next time these come off, it's going to be easy. Now that we have our rotor back in place, it's all a matter of reversing the removal. We're going to clean this up, get the two 17 millimeters back in place. We'll show you how to put those in and torque them back down. And then get our new pad situated, put the caliper back on, and this brake job's complete. All right, guys, now that we have cleaned up our mounting bracket, we're gonna go ahead and get it ready for install once again. Just a quick cleanup, nothing crazy. These are our two 17 millimeter hex bolts that are gonna hold that in. 17 millimeter socket that we're going to use. When you put these in, you want to torque these down to about 80, 81 foot pounds. So I'm going to go ahead and get these situated back in their home. And we'll go ahead and tighten them down. Always get them started in by hand first. Makes life a lot easier. And torque wrench on here. That's one. That's two. Now we can go ahead and get our pads going. We got our rotor secured in place. We got our set screw torqued down. You got our caliper carrier or caliper bracket in place. Both 17 millimeter bolts are torqued down to spec. Now we're gonna go ahead and install our new brake pads. These are our new ATEs. Taking these apart, it's cool to see this had an ATE stamping on it. The caliper has an ATE stamping on it, so you can tell everything is original. Now, I personally, when I do these, I like to put a little bit of brake paste on the contact points where the caliper is going to be touching the back of the pad, as well as, if you want to call them, the anchors or the ends where they sit on the caliper bracket themselves, just to help them move around, do their thing under braking, and again, keep them from rusting in there, especially being in New England. Even though this car never sees the winter, it's still a 33-year-old car and it's still New England. It is possible that just humidity and moisture along are gonna get to it at some point in its life. So we'll get that situated and just a little bit's all you need. If you're still using your brake sensors or they're still working on your vehicle, you can see the notches cut out in the pad so that you can mount those back into place. This is what it's gonna look like once that's applied on there. Again, totally could be overkill, but it doesn't hurt it. You can set them right into place just like so. And instead of getting all globbed up on the pad here, I'm gonna go ahead and just put the paste on the back here of the caliper once I'm ready to put them on. Your back pad is always typically gonna be a little bit different, and these cars are always gonna look like this. It's gonna have the little clamps that hold it into the inside of the piston or on the caliper. I always like to put a little bit on these tabs too so they don't rust over time and make any noise if they're rattling in there while they're in the car. So I'm gonna go ahead and put a little bit of liquid moly brake anti-squeal paste on here, same thing on my ends, and a little bit on the backing plate here where it comes in contact with the piston. And we're gonna go ahead and pop them into place and get them on the caliper. And just like so, you can see the ends. I got the little clamps. Now, like I mentioned before, I'm gonna be repainting these calipers. So I'm not gonna go ahead and glob on a total amount of brake paste like I would, but if I would go into, I would do the same surrounding area just here, like I'm gonna do on the front pads, where the piston's gonna be in contact to keep any moisture and humidity out and avoid any corrosion. Now I'm gonna go ahead and get these in place on the caliper. I'll get you guys in for a closer view, and then we'll snap our zip tie and put the caliper into place. All right, guys, and just like that, we have our pad ready to go. Make sure all three are going in place inside the piston here. If it's fighting you, feel free to close the clamps down a little bit. I'll try to get it like this first before we alter them. And just like that, they're in. Make sure that none of the pistons are sticking out, or I'm sorry, make sure that none of the clamps are sticking out or went the wrong place. Now that that's situated, I'm gonna get something to cut the zip tie free, and we're gonna go ahead and mount the caliper back into place, put our guide pins back in, torque those down to spec, put the rattle clip back on, and we are done. Cut the old zip tie off right there. Now, again, keep in mind, some more paste would be going back here. But because, again, I am painting these, I'm not gonna go full bore, simply just to show you guys the process here. That baby's gonna sit right there, all snug, ready to take a nap. Clean up after yourselves if you got paste or grease or anything everywhere. I mean, it's your car, do what you want, but I like to keep it as clean as possible looking, so it looks nice, especially if you have wheels that show your brakes on the other side. Got my guide pins all cleaned up, ready to go. Now, per new TIS, any repair manual you're gonna see, they always say these do not need to be lubed. I've been doing brakes for the last 10 years. I've always lubed these. It's gonna be totally dealer's choice if you wanna lube these or not. If you're going to, you can use that same liquid moly ceramic paste. In this case, I'm not gonna lube them just because one, I just cleaned them up to show you guys what they look like when they're clean. You can replace them every brake job. It's not necessary. These are in really good shape. And two, I am taking these back off after we are done wrapping up to paint. So it'll be counterproductive. But if you're going to do them, you're going to do a little dab on the side. Just spread it around. Send them in through the back and you'll be good to go there. I'm going to take you back with me. Show you how to get these on. Oh, yeah. It's Bilstein V8s, baby. All right, take 1 million with this thing. DIYs. Now you got your caliper in place, you're gonna wanna go ahead and secure your guide pins in. I like to push them in one at a time. You can kinda hear the threads click into place once they find their home against the caliper bracket or the carrier bracket. There's two. Go ahead and snug these down. Again, you're gonna need a 7mm hex to get that into place. I like to start them by hand if possible, just to save a lot of the back and forth on the ratchet. And also to make sure that they're going in properly, they're not cross-threading or anything of that nature. Right. And same thing, all these have a torque spec. These are going to be about roughly anywhere. Honestly, these don't need to be that tight. Anywhere from 17 to 20 foot-pounds at most is all you're going to want to do for these. And that's that. Now all that's left to do is put on the anti-rattle clip. This one sometimes can be a pain in the butt, sometimes not, depending. I either get them perfectly the first time or I take 10 tries trying to put them on. In this case, we got it right the first time. So, anti-rattle clip is on, and that concludes the mounting of the brake caliper and pads. All that's left, if you're still running your brake pad wear sensor, is that you go ahead and hook it into that little notch that we showed you on the pad earlier. Make sure it's routed properly. In this case, this one can route through the brake bleeder right here. Clip her in and she's in. Thanks again, guys. If you stuck around this far, if you're gonna go ahead and wrap up this job for the day, feel free to put your wheel back on, tighten down your lug bolts to 88 foot-pounds, lower it safely. Don't forget about that jack stand under there and enjoy the ride. If you like what you saw, please be sure to leave us a like below. If you have any questions, drop a comment in the comment box. All the parts that we use from FCP Euro will be in the description below, as well as a list on the tools needed again in case you missed a step. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe, be well, see you soon.